Welcome. Thank you for joining us here at AmazingLove.org. And, you know, it's been a dream of mine to reach people all across the world with a message of Jesus and his love. And so whether you're joining us from near or far, so glad that you're here. And we'd love to hear what God is doing in your life. So if he's blessed you by this ministry, please email us at impact@amazinglove@gmail.com. If you'd like to support this ministry and make sermons like this possible every week ongoing, please go to AmazingLove.org and go to our giving tab. But now may God bless you. May he guide you. May he speak into your life and direct you all through the power of his love. Thank you.
Dear friends, gather. I invite you to pray with me. We're just going to ask God to bless the preaching of his word. Heavenly Father, your people are here and they need you. And Lord, I ask that you speak specifically to their own hearts today, a word of encouragement and a word of direction. And Lord, as we gather, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts, may they be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I wanted to start off today by considering everyone's favorite topic, which is food poisoning. Does anyone remember getting food poisoning? Anyone ever have it? I still remember when I got it. I was a teenager, and our family would always order Chinese food on Friday nights. And I love spicy things, and so we got the spicy things. And in Chinese food were these red peppers. You ever see these? I remember getting sick off of one, and what happened next? Man, it was a gruesome bodily mix of violence and pain. There's this hot sauce called spontaneous combustion. I'm pretty sure that's what my body did. So you're welcome for that grossness. Anyway, and those experiences, if you've ever had them, whatever it did to you, they kind of stick with you. In fact, it stuck with me so much that I was in the airport the other day. I ordered some Chinese food, and look at what I found. There's my nemesis, right? Now, I have a question for you. See if you get this right or wrong. Do you think I ate that red pepper? 15 years have gone by. Is it enough time to eat the red pepper? Who thinks I ate the red pepper? Okay, if you think, I'm not that brave. No, I didn't eat the red pepper again. I'm not sure you can eat those without spontaneous combustion. Maybe, is that true? I don't know. I guess we will never know. I guess I'm never going to find that out, right? And I have a point to this story. And I believe part of the reason we do what we do is because we're afraid of things. And where do we get these phobias? Here's what I believe. I think that phobias are predicated on a painful past. The reason you're afraid of some things is because you had a traumatic experience with them, right? You might not have been afraid of heights until you fell, right? You might not have been afraid of that food until you actually ate it. I don't know what it is. But this morning, we need to move past peppers onto people. Isn't it true that sometimes the fear of people we have is predicated on a painful past? For instance, in our society, there are phrases about our aversion to people, phrases that are common, and maybe you can even fill in the blank, like, I had a bad experience with a man, and so maybe someone had a bad experience with a man says, all men are, pigs, right? Where'd we get that? Because someone had a traumatic experience with a particular individual, and now a whole category, a whole gender is written off. But I don't mean to pick on just one gender. I'm equally picking on. So why don't we go to women? Sometimes men can say, all women want is my beautiful soul, right? Beautiful soul is what they're... It's my money, right? And every now and then you have this bad experience with just one individual that then translates into a whole category of people, right? And now you can't trust all women are just that way. Songs about it. Or what about this? You can't trust White Sox fans. You can't trust the government, right? Because we live in Illinois, right? And the day we pass a budget will be a great day, right? That would be awesome, right? Be nice to have a budget. I don't know how our government does it. Anyway, different topic. Or maybe you can't trust a certain profession. Or maybe you can't trust a certain race. Or maybe you can't trust, even pastors. I remember when I was lumped in this category, there was this fallout with the Catholic priest. And by the way, I'm not a Catholic priest. But anyway, and you probably heard about this. And for a while, I was lumped in the same category as if all pastors and priests were pedophiles. And I'm like, that's not fair at all. But you know what I'm talking about. And this is a problem. This is a problem because I believe as people, as a society, and especially if you call yourself a Christian, you might be able to write off peppers, but you probably shouldn't write off people, right? Anyone know what I'm talking about? You probably can write off foods, but when it comes to people, I think we need to do a little bit more work. But there's more to this issue. And probably bigger than even our fear of what's going on is how people of the past are still affecting our present and on to the future, which is a ridiculous notion. What happened in the past has a way of sticking with us. Andy Stanley, he put it this way. Look at what he said. He said, who wants to allow the people who have hurt you the most to continue to have influence on your future? None of us would say, yeah, please, please, you know, the person's not in my life anymore, hurt me so bad. Please let that affect me. Right? And yet it happens. So what do we do? What do we do? What do we do? Well, I believe where we end is where we started. And when we first started this series, I gave you a quote by Rick Warren. And it's still one that I continue to believe is true. Rick Warren said, you can be products of your past. Your past, it can shape you. It can inform you. It can even influence who you are today. But it doesn't have to make you a prisoner. It doesn't have to lock you in that cell. It doesn't have to dictate your future and your experiences ongoing. And the reason I believe this, the reason I have a deep conviction over this, is because I know the person and the nature of Jesus Christ. And at this point, I wanted to welcome you if you're new to the Christian faith. There is no one better than Jesus. He is the reason that we've gathered. He is the power of this place. If you see him for as beautiful as he is, you will never be the same. And I believe when we were locked in the prison cell that the devil had on us, and when the devil wanted to dictate our destiny, he released us. For when we were sinners, Christ died for us. And I tell you, you are no longer children. You are no longer slaves of sin. You are no longer slaves of fear, but you are children of God. And you are children of liberty. And you are children of peace. And you no longer have to be destined by the devil for your future. I believe it with all my heart. So that's why we did this series called Fresh Start. So that we could look at a new year and say, I'm going to get over some stuff. I'm going to be liberated from some stuff this year. And it's going to go better for me because I went through this process. And so we talked about three things. We talked about owning it, rethinking it, and today's releasing it, the third part of the process. I wanted to catch you up if you weren't here for the first part of owning it. We talked about a pie and who's at fault. That many times when a mess occurs, yes, we'd like to blame other people, but there's still some percentage that has to do with us, right? There's still something that maybe we could have learned from the mess, still something we have to own. And if you don't process that, it's still not going to go well for you. You can go in the same situation, and the only thing that was truly the same was you, and you're the problem maker. Well, we dealt with that already in Own It. Today, Release It is really talking about the other portion of the pie. We're really saying, okay, if I process this right, it's going to help me. But now, God, how do I process this? Okay? So we're going to turn to God's Word. And it's funny because a Christian named Paul was writing to other Christians in Ephesus. And I think he had the same sermon series going on. It seems to me he was writing about a fresh start. And I want to give you some words before the words of our lesson. This is the setup. This is the sermon series he was in. He said this. He said, you were taught with regard to your former way of life, maybe it's 2016, put that off. Put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, and rather be made new in the attitude of your minds. Talked about that last week. To put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. Paul is saying again, you need a fresh start. Don't let what happened in 2016 happen in 2017. And he's talking specifically about sinful behaviors and attitudes, right? But as we look at the fresh start that Paul would have for us, are you curious at all what this looks like? You know, maybe you'd ask Paul, as I'm looking in 2017, what would the new self look like? What do you want from me, Paul? What would you want from me, God? If you're curious at all, can we just ask that together? Can you say this with me? Ready? What does the new self look like? Well, I'm so glad you asked. That's awesome. Thanks for set you up, sorry. Anyway, I'm cheesy. Anyway, because that's what Paul's going to answer. And so we get into our lesson. Let's read from either our worship folders or on the screen. He's going to say, you want the new self? Here it is. He says, in your anger, don't sin. Don't let the sun go down while you're still angry, and don't give the devil a foothold. Anyone who's been stealing must steal no longer, but must work, doing something useful with their own hands, that they may have something to share with those who are in need. It's interesting, he wants them to work, and we don't have a sermon for this, just in order to provide for those who are in need. That's incredible. We don't always think that way when it comes to money. Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that they may benefit those who listen. That'd be a good new self. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, with whom you are sealed for the day of redemption. Get rid of all bitterness and rage and anger, brawling and slander, along with every form of malice. Be kind and compassionate to one another. There's always a room for kindness. It translates in every language. Forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. So when we talk about releasing it today, it's really a church word that we call forgiveness. We get to talk about forgiveness today. And may God bless us. May he work in our hearts. All right. Well, I love giving visual explanations, and today I've brought my laundry basket with me. And I don't do the laundry at our house all too often. My wife is awesome at it. Thank you so much for helping. We are teammates. This is great. But I get the concept of doing laundry, especially a load of whites. I don't know if anyone's done a load of whites. I understand that to do it properly, you turn it on the high temperature water, right? You press hot water. And then if you want to do it better, you put bleach in there. And then there was this one time, if you really want to do it well, there's this stuff called OxyClean. And I soaked some whites in OxyClean for like 2 hours, and even the yellow spots got away. It was amazing. They almost were like glowing, right? But if I am doing the laundry and my goal is to clean this up, my white shirts, is it going to help me if I take some red Gatorade and do this with it? You don't have to clean that. We'll do that together. It's okay. Did that help the situation at all? I don't mean to insult your intelligence. Don't worry. I have a point coming. But no, this hasn't helped anything, not even my own outfit, right? We've just had more mess. And so I have a very simple point. Here it is. Are you ready for it? Whole visual just for this. You can't clean a mess by adding mess. Right? Boy, is that profound. Like light bulbs just went off everywhere. Right? But I got a point. Because sometimes we're tempted to clean a mess by adding one to it. See, Paul, he said this. He said, when you're angry, there's a mess there, isn't there? And it's usually because someone has hurt you. And our gut reaction, I know how I'll clean the mess. I'll add to it. Someone said something about me. Guess what I'll do? I'll say something about them. Someone punched me. I'm going to punch them. Someone had a low blow against me. I know how to solve it. The red Gatorade of saying something about them, right? But it doesn't make any sense, right? You don't clean a mess by adding more to it. You don't clean up sin by adding sin on top of sin. It just makes everything messier. Now I have to go to the dry cleaners, right? But we have a problem because, well, we get angry. And our society gets angry. There's a lot of anger this week, I think. On every realm, there's anger all around. Let's go on Facebook, right? So what do we do with our anger? Because it's true that someone has hurt us. What are we supposed to do with those feelings of rage? Where do we put them? Where do we go from here? How can we deal if they're true that there's rage inside? Well, I want to turn to God. I want to turn a little bit to God. Did God ever get angry? What do you think? Did God ever get angry? I'm seeing some nodding heads. And maybe you heard the same childhood story I heard when Jesus went to the temple. Do you remember this? It's the first time I learned about righteous anger. I'm like, righteous anger, I want some of that, right? I've always been chided for my anger, but how could I be righteously angry? Well, Jesus, he went into the temple, and he saw that there were money changers. And they were taking a place of worship and making it a place of theft and consumerism. And so look at Jesus. Just get a picture of Jesus. This is the sinless Son of God, mind you, okay? Look what he does. He makes a whip out of cords. Indiana Jones-like, I don't know. Drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of money changers, overturned their tables, and to those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." He got angry, didn't he? He was upset. He was flying off the handle a little bit in his anger. And this isn't an isolated incident. In fact, if you read the whole of Scripture, which I encourage you to do, you find over and over that God gets angry at something. And let me tell you what God rages at. He rages at sin and sinners. Every time. A holy God does not like unholiness. A loving God does not like lovelessness. And the part of us, there's a part of us that says, I like this about God. And part of us likes this about God because it means when someone hurts us, this is what it means. It means he's not okay with that. When you've been hurt, he doesn't gloss over it. He doesn't condone it. He doesn't say, you know, rub some dirt on it and get back up. No, he said, what happened to you? That was not right. What happened to you was unfair. What happened to you was awful. And there's going to be an accounting for it. And then part of us, you know, in the inside says, get him, God, avenge me, right? We love that part of God. Solve all the people who hurt me, right? All those other sinners. But then there's this other part that doesn't really like this because we find if we're sober and thinking about ourselves that we are sinners too. And so there's part of us that wonders, God, if I fall into this category, what about me? So what was God's answer for his rage? I consider some of the things we do when we're raging. Sometimes all you need is ice cream, right? Ice cream makes everything better. Or sometimes it's shopping, all our different ways of coping. Or maybe it's watching football or grabbing a beer or gossiping or shouting or punching or donuts. They're beautiful, aren't they? But does God go to any of these cisterns for hope? Any of these avenues that are going to help him? I'm just going to shout a little bit more, going to get a little bit more angry, going to punch some people. The only way past God's rage was this, wasn't it? And there's this beautiful passage from Isaiah that says, and he was pierced for us, for our sins. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. See, God understood that when we sinned against him, it incurred a debt. And the only way of paying for the debt was for someone to pay it. And he sent his son to pay the entirety of our debt so that we could be set free. And I want you to know, maybe you're just joining us, maybe you're watching online for the first time, and there's something inside of you that says, yes, God must be mad at me because of what I did. And that's only partly true. You need the fuller revelation that though he was mad, he has paid for that sin completely, fully, all in full, so that we could be set free, so that you could know, no, God delights in you through Jesus. God delights to call you son and daughter. God delights to set you free and give you peace, and that peace, it is yours, even if you're hearing it for the very first time. Because when Jesus died, he died for all of us. For mankind, for the whole world, so we could be set free. How good is it to live in freedom? You need to live in it today. We heard already, please don't gloss over these words, as far as the east is from the west. That's forever. If I draw a line as far as the east is from the west, like I can't even see where that line stops. And that's how far God has removed my sin through the cross. And it says, as a father has compassion on his children, you mean you're going to be like a parent's love? Are there any parents in the building? Like that parent love is kind of tender and dear, isn't it? You can hurt me, but you best not hurt my child. You saying that's how you look at me? Man, guys, we got to dwell there. We got to soak there. We got to sit there until it takes root in our hearts and in our minds. We've been released. So you want to know the answer for rage? Here it is. Rage is quieted by the cross of Christ. God's not raging at you. He loves you through Jesus. But that answer for us is the same answer for other people. You ready to move on? There's this dichotomy. We love to hear we're forgiven, don't we? We love it like mine, 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 mine. But it's so hard to then give to others what we got. But it reminds me of snacks that you bring for birthdays. Does anyone go to a school where you can bring birthday snacks, birthday treats? We still do. Let's say like mom makes cupcakes for a birthday. And she makes 20 of the cupcakes. And one of those cupcakes is going to go to the birthday child, in our case a girl. But let's say that the child goes into the room, and though there are enough cupcakes for all the students and the teacher and the faculty, let's say the child camps out in the corner and is like snarfing down all the cupcakes, right? You know, and mom's not there, but if mom heard about this and come home and all the cupcakes are trying to be snarfed, and you can't eat 20, but they're trying, right? Mom, at one point or another, would say, you had one cupcake, and it was enough for you, and it was tasty, and it was good, but they aren't just your cupcakes. Not just yours. Made for other people. I have a point. God is telling you today, those aren't just your cupcakes. They're not. I like that you have a cupcake. I hope it's tasty. I hope it's filling. I hope you're happy about it, but it's not just yours. You have got to share the cupcakes. Life doesn't work without it. Relationships don't work without it. And you don't work without sharing the cupcakes. Let's talk about it. So Paul gets into this. And now he's saying, okay, release others as I have released you. And he gives us some information on when to do this. When to do this. Here's the information on when. He says, don't let the sun go down while you're still angry. Now I quibble with this a little bit. I quibble because I've had experience that sometimes it's better to let the emotions subside. You know what I'm saying? And so sometimes it's better to wake up the next morning and then, you know, from an emotionally neutral standpoint, talk about things. But I think I get his point. And here's what I think his point is. I'll use a gym analogy because it's January and maybe we're still going to the gym. I don't know. But every now and then I have a protein shake. I drink Muscle Milk, and it can be very tasty. And I have this blender bottle, and it does a great job, so it's not chunky, and it blends it up all real good, and it's the sound it makes. But what I've noticed is that if I use the blender bottle and I let it sit out, which I've done for this illustration because I love you guys, I use the blender bottle and then I sit out, the longer that I let it sit out, when I do this, and I smell that. I think a dead animal's inside of here. Because what you need to know about the protein powder is that you need to clean this ASAP. All right? The longer you wait, it will be like some morbid science experiment of smells. I mean, it is just awful. It makes me question a little bit what's in the protein powder in the first place. But anyway, I'm just saying, with blender bottles, you got to get, because otherwise it is going to smell bad. Right? That's Paul's point about releasing others in forgiveness. He says, you gotta release others ASAP. It can't wait till next week. It can't wait till next year. The longer you leave that sit there, it is going to smell bad. And I'm not sure how that speaks to you. Maybe it says something about what happened yesterday. Maybe it says something about what happened this week. Maybe it says something about what's happening years ago. And God is saying, if you haven't yet dealt with that, you have got to. You have got to. It's not getting any better sitting around. He has more to say. Because if you don't, look what happens. He says, don't give the devil a foothold. If you keep that here, what you're doing, another way of translating this is you're giving an opportunity for the devil to set up shop. You're giving the devil a place. You're saying, devil, why don't you live with me for a while, make a nice room for you here, see how life goes with you right by my side. I heard another Bible commentator use this passage, and he said, replace devil with who actually hurts you. And I thought that was a phenomenal exercise. What happens sometimes is don't let whoever it is that hurts you. When you don't release it, do you know they're with you? And that's so frustrating because sometimes they're not even in our lives anymore, and yet the worst of them is sticking with us in a horrible way. Don't let whoever that is who hurt you grab a foothold. So what do we do? Okay, we got to get to it soon. What do? Some Bible scholars have said to make a list. Make a list of who hurt you and what they owe you. And I quibble with this a little bit, because if you've forgiven it at all, it's not always helpful to go back. That's like a reopening the wound. So if you've already dealt with this, don't go back. It's not helpful. But it kind of reminded me of an efficiency thing mentally. When they talk about work productivity, maybe you've heard this, that when you have tasks, you should write them down. You ever hear this? Anyone with me? And the reason for writing them down is so that your brain doesn't go back to it, especially like midnight. You got to email Sally. You got to write it down. I wonder spiritually if the same thing is happening to us. Is it possible our souls are keeping going back to that same old thing just because we didn't release it? So a list. What would it look like? Well, maybe it looks like this. He betrayed me in sixth grade. What he owes me is the friendships and the trust I lost. Mom said that years ago and owes me the self-esteem I lost. She lied to me, owes me all the time I lost believing the lie. He was absent, owes me the love I longed for and never got. She stole from me, owes me this dollar amount she forgot about me, owes me the trust I lost for people. What's really interesting about going through this process in actuality is you find that what you think you're owed isn't able to be paid by them anyway. Is that catching with you at all? What they did years ago and what they took is really gone anyway. If they wanted to, from their heart of hearts, pay you back, they are unable to do that. So better is for us to pay it once and for all. Saying, you don't owe me because I'm paying this one. And because I can't check your homework and I don't know if you're going to do this week, I want to invite you in these moments. If the Spirit has brought anything to mind, if you're thinking about anything particular, I just want to give you a few moments to put it on this list, to mentally transfer it, and let's put it on this list. And I'm not sure what it is. Maybe it was in grade school. Maybe it was in your family. Maybe it was someone particular, a person, a name you still have. I would invite you to, again, transfer that here. And then what we do? Love fire. We got to let it go. We have got to give to others what God has done for us. And though we might not ever forget it, because we can't according to our humanity, we have to wipe their slate clean so that not a spot remains. There's freedom here. There's freedom here for you to identify who and how to forgive. And because it's so clean and so wonderful, let me give you advice going forward. If you do this list now or later, please don't bring dead things back to life. I need to tell you, please don't bring the hurt back to life through word or thought. If you've truly forgiven it, don't bring it back up in your conversations. If family friends or friends are bringing it up, say, please, I've forgiven that. I've let it go. Please let me do that. Don't bring that up again. And even though this is harder in the world of our thoughts, we just forgive it every time it comes up. We just release it every time, because bringing it back to life is not helpful. But what would happen if we truly did this? What would the world look like? Maybe there wouldn't be as many women walking around saying all men are pigs. And maybe one experience with one man would not dictate your experience and your understanding of all men. And maybe men wouldn't be walking around saying all women want is my money. And the experience you had with one woman wouldn't dictate your future with every woman you meet from there. And maybe you'd stop just categorizing groups of people, saying you can't trust this whole broad group. Because your one experience, it might inform you, it might shape you to a degree, but it will not prison lock you from how you treat people going forward. And what you'll truly find is who is set free, which is you. The real reason to do this is not for anyone else, but for you. Lewis Smedes nailed it on the head when he said this: to forgive is to set a prisoner free and discover that all along that prisoner was you. So may God bless you to forgive because of the same reason of our forgiveness, the cross of Christ. As it was enough for us, it is enough for everyone. And now as we end this series, let me pray for you. We pray. Help me, Lord, to know who and what and how to forgive. Let anger not get the best of me. Let me see myself first freely and fully forgiven by you so that I may also offer to others what you have shared with me. Lord, I don't want the devil, I don't want any other person to have a foothold or a place in my life or heart. So release me as I release others of what I think I have owed. Grant me the peace and the strength that only you can provide, and I pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.